It is 5 p.m. It's November 30th, and we are coming to you live again from Charlottesville, from the studio.
The studio.
Which is actually about to get enhanced with some amazing studio furniture made by our dear friend Craig Ernst. So that's coming pretty soon.
Very exciting.
And then we're going to have the whole thing set up. So
stay tuned.
That's a fun thing. And we've got the workshop coming up this weekend. We've got people coming from across the country.
We're very excited.
That's super exciting.
Yeah. But have those people
Kim, the producer of the Butterflies of the Week, is going to set the stage for what we're doing for the next 6 weeks. So, Kim, take it away. What are we doing?
Okay, we're just having a slight change of pace, but adding a bit of interest and intrigue into the butterflies. A lot of you know, but some of you don't, that David has done tons of things around the world way before any of these butterflies. And of course, you must know that he must have a lot of special skills that he has utilized around the world. And he was able to utilize them to bring you the facts that he does and that we do for Butterflies of the Week. And there's been a lot of conversation about, okay, so where to with the world from here? You know, what's possible, or what can the systems of the world look like? What can humanity, you know, what's possible really? And, you know, it's not everyone that can look at all systems that make up the world and how and things are and people are and money systems and banking systems, you know, how people in communities function, like the whole gamut of things. And David has been teaching these six areas or six umbrellas of different systems for over 20 years, and which is what we'll be teaching and sharing in the workshop. But we felt it would be a lovely idea to start on these six areas, and today's one is commodity. And we want to start sharing visions of what these systems can look like, and you know, today's one, yeah, is commodity, and that's David's specialty, and you can talk underwater on these things, but it's very inspirational, and it's just really, really great information to have. And I will hand it over for today's first of the six, which
so,
is commodity.
Episode one, and to give you a sense of where we're going on the next 6 week journey, I wanted to give you a little bit of a framework. Over the past several decades, we've used a process called integral accounting, and integral accounting is something you can look up. I've written about it. We've done a lot of presentations. We've done a lot of workshops. We do a lot of work around the fact that to understand a thing, it's really critical that we look at that thing through multiple lenses. Basically, for the last 3,000 years of our modern record of how we tell our stories, and I'm saying that, you know, with all of the cumbersomeness that it represents, because how long we've been telling stories like this, we really don't know. But certainly for the last several thousand years, there's been this question of what is reality? And it's funny because as much as we think we understand about the world right now, the truth is that on the best of days, the current explanations we have, whether it's for life, whether it's for matter, whether it's for the cosmos, somewhere around 90% or 95% of what we experience in reality, we have no model to describe, which says that in the best of days, whether it's the DNA that is inside of the model of the cell, whether it is the light that transmits across the universe, whether it is this mystery of how gravity works, whatever those things are, basically we have a 90% plus question mark going. We think we understand maybe 5 or 6 or 7 or 8%, but basically 90%+, we've got no clue. I think it's kind of funny that we live in a world where, with all of the adherence to science and to, you know, the values of what we have in our kind of modern view of ourselves, we basically have a 90% question mark that says, yeah, but there's a lot of stuff we just don't know. So we developed a process, I developed a process many years ago called integral accounting, and what it does is rather than trying to define what something is, it takes somewhat of the German philosophical approach and some of the early Greek philosophical approaches and says, wouldn't it be better to actually experience things through as many types of perceptions as possible? What are the ingredients that go into a thing? What are the ways in which that thing can be perceived? What are the stories that we tell around that thing? What are the values that are embedded or the values that we impose on a thing? What are the hierarchies that we use? What are the artifacts of experience that allow us to engage with a thing? And ultimately, what does that thing do to either improve or harm our existence? And the reason why this one is so important is in the middle of what we've been experiencing now for the last year, very explicitly, this is the anniversary of the Chinese outbreak, allegedly, that gave rise to all of the craziness. We actually have to stop and ask ourselves the question, do we actually know that RNA exists? Do we know that nucleic acids exist? Do we know that DNA exists? Do we know that viruses exist? Do we know that protein exists? Or are these things theoretical constructs? Are they stories that we tell to try to make sense of a world that largely we don't understand? And the answer, certainly in the last now 75 years, is that we've adopted a model of life and we've adopted a model of living systems informed by things like biochemistry, things like genetics. We've adopted a model where we tell a story in which things like nucleic acids, things like DNA and RNA, things like viruses, things like cells, we tell a story in which those things are treated as objective fact. But we don't ask the question, are they? Do they actually meet a standard of what is? And that's a really interesting question because let's assume for the sake of argument that viruses don't exist. That they're a theoretical model, they're a framework in which we can think about ways in which biological material interacts with biological material. And by the way, I'm not making a statement whether something does or doesn't exist. What I'm trying to help us understand is that we've adopted a view that says that we are informed through the lens of what we are told reality is, but we don't ask the question, is reality in fact what we've been told, and is what we've been told consistent with the model of reality? And so, what is? Well, in the first of the six dimensions, and I'll jump back to this just for a moment, we have six different dimensions we look at: commodity, custom and culture, knowledge, money or value, technology, and well-being. Those are the six dimensions, and each one of these is going to have its own special feature over the next 6 weeks. But starting with commodity, what is? And this is a really interesting question because what is feels like it's only part of a question, doesn't it? What is? And then you want the next thing to be what is a thing. But here's the challenge, and this is the reason why the slide says what is. I choose the term commodity for its Proto-Indo-European definition. 3,500 years ago, the term commodus, which actually became Latin commodus, the term from which we get the term commodity meant a thing that has the capacity to be measured. So quite literally, the term commodus or commodity is something that can be measured. Now, in our use of that term, we've added things like fungibility, we've added things like the ability to adapt a thing, but at its heart, we've built a worldview that is actually drawn out of a series of constructs in which a couple formula serve as the bedrock of the way we see the world. Force. Mass times acceleration. Well, what's mass? Well, mass is the amount of stuff that goes into a particular volume. But that's built on a construct that says that there's a volume, or there's a shape, or there's a container, or there's a thing.
A limit.
And there is stuff, mass, that's gone into that thing, and that force and forces are those things in acceleration. In other words, that they have to be moving for there to be a force. So force equals mass times acceleration, acceleration implying some sort of movement or energy or motion. And then obviously, our favorite equation that is nothing but a falsehood, E equals mc squared, the speed of light squared on mass is somehow some estimation of energy. But each one of these things is derived from a worldview that's actually quite fascinating, and we don't spend much time thinking about this. But as we go into the what is next, what is that next expression of our lives, our livelihoods, our engagement with each other, one of the fundamental assumptions that is made in the concept of commodity, one of the fundamental assumptions that's made in how we see the world, is we see edges. Now, that sounds really simple to say, but the consequence of this is actually quite profound. Let me ask a simple question. Is the sun 93 million miles away from the Earth? That sounds like a very simple question. You can go to look it up on a Wikipedia page, and lo and behold, it will probably say something to the effect of, yep, the sun is 93 million miles away. But here's a question. What assumption has to be made for that statement to be true? Well, the assumption that has to be made for that statement to be true is that the sun has a boundary, that has an edge. Because if that's not the case, what if the sun actually thinks that we in the solar system are part of it? And now all of a sudden there's no distance, but there is a variable amplitude of experience in proximity. Listen to what I just said, a variable experience of amplitude in proximity. In other words, I'm not suggesting that there isn't a very hot reacting gas ball that happens to be emitting light and emitting heat or energy or anything else. I'm not suggesting that may not be the case, but I am asking the question is, does that energy travel across a distance? Well, remember that the question I'm asking is actually asking a very important fundamental question. Is the sun a thing? Or are we part of a big thing which includes the sun? Are we somehow connected to that? Can we get ill from a virus? Well, that would imply that somehow or another that we exist in some sort of isolation, and then this thing called a virus exists in some sort of isolation, and when those things come into proximity with each other, then different effects can happen. But what we don't have a construct about is what the internal error is when we assume that things have edges, things have boundaries, things have mass. Now, here's the funny thing. If we actually look at the model of an atom, which is the building block, we're told, of what becomes matter and what becomes the expression of things that have energy and can engage with energy, the funny thing is, when you take all of the pieces apart in the current model, the protons, the neutrons, the electrons, you take all those pieces apart, there's nothing there. In fact, there are no pieces. There's not a thing. There's not an electron. There's not a proton. There's not a neutron. Those are constructs of energy that happen to be in some sort of association. And as they associate, they begin to express a thing. But the funny thing is, none of them absolutely exist without connections. They don't have edges. In fact, it is their coming together that makes them a thing. But remember what I just said, it's their coming together. It's not the edges of them. It's not their definition of what they're not. It's the inclusion of the what they are. So the question is, what would a world look like where we focused on connections rather than on edges. Mm. What would it look like to have property where property was defined by what the expression or the use of a thing was rather than some sort of geometric shape? What would it look like if we saw things not for their external reflectivity, but for their internal essence? Now think about this for a moment. This is one of the things I like to do in my classes. If you think about a leaf, is a leaf a particular color? And many of you will think this is probably a trick question, because it is a trick question. Because the question of how we perceive color, just like the perception of how we perceive shape, is a very interesting logical problem. Because reflection is that which is not absorbed. In other words, a shape that we see as a shape only occurs in the reflection of the energy that's not absorbed by that shape. A color that we perceive is only that which is not absorbed by the thing that we're actually looking at. So the only color a leaf isn't is green. The only color this sweater isn't is blue. Why? Because the chemical composition that makes up the material, that makes up the dyes in this particular fabric, those chemical constructions, those little crystals absorb all the energy that's not blue and send back a reflection of not all other color. The only color that they send back is blue. Your dress is gray because it's absorbing everything that's not gray. Mm-hmm. But what if we actually examine the world through the lens of the essence of a thing rather than the thing that it reflects, the thing that it rejects? This is a very profound point, people. Because if we saw ourselves based on our connections rather than on our edges, much of our system level thinking would fall apart.
Yep.
And maybe that's a good thing. Maybe we should see ourselves as interconnected wholes rather than individuated edges. Maybe we should see ourselves as that which we bring into each other's lives, that experience that enriches the whole, rather than for the individual narrative that says that what's in it for me. So the question of a commodity, what is, becomes a very fundamental question we should be asking as we go forward in the what is next. Because, and listen very carefully, the agencies of chemical companies, the agencies of pharmaceutical companies, the agencies of healthcare testing companies, the agencies of government, the agencies of social order are all built around defining edges and boundaries. It's us versus them. It's good versus evil. It's valuable versus not valuable. But all of these things are based on the reflectivity of what something isn't, rather than the essence of the thing that is. So, what's next? Well, what's next is a world in which we can ask the question, are we going to build systems as we move forward which are predicated on connectivity, where the edges and boundaries do not become the easy target for manipulation, for polarization, for separation? Because if we did that, what suddenly goes away? Well, force goes away, doesn't it? Because mass is a question not of connection. Mass is a question of segregation. Acceleration is a function of distance. But if distance doesn't exist, then acceleration doesn't exist either. And if light is present, not some remote thing somewhere out there that actually finds its way through some sort of photonic transmission to here, whatever there and here are, then all of a sudden, Einstein, that wonderful, crazy, wild-haired German, actually got it wrong, not by a little bit, but got it wrong by a lot, because he squared the assumption the speed of light squared. But speed is only in existence if distance, separation, and time are real. And those things are things we should reconsider. Because maybe the reason why we can't understand photosynthesis, maybe the reason why we can't understand the brilliance of how a seed germinates, maybe the reason why we can't understand how living systems interact with their ecosystem is because we've imposed a worldview that says that edges and boundaries and separation are the given, not because they are, but it's the reflected property of what they're not. Which leads us to a little tiny challenge. What makes this relatively esoteric topic so critically important for us to examine? And the answer is really simple. We've adopted a worldview that says that we only value what we measure. Now, let me make an observation. I've fallen for this one. So have most of us. But I have. I've fallen for this. I actually thought that the idea of doing this Butterfly of the Week, when Kim came up with the idea in March of 2020, I thought it was a crazy idea. I felt like my ideas were just kind of interesting, and I didn't really feel like there was a whole lot of reason to get on to Facebook Live or to YouTube to do anything. And Kim kept saying, no, it's actually important. Well, I made a mistake. The mistake I made was, at the end of these videos, I look online, I look on Facebook, I look on Google and YouTube, and I see how many people saw it. Does how many people saw it matter? You know, here's the funny thing, right? The question is, we fall into this trap of something has value because we measure it. Well, it turns out that at Thanksgiving dinner this year, every single person sitting around the table at our Thanksgiving, and we, because Kim is an Australian and they have this crazy idea of having a holiday, and then after the holiday, they have the Boxing Day holiday.
For more reasons, holidays the more.
Yeah, more holidays the better. But for Thanksgiving and our obligatory Boxing Thanksgiving, everybody sitting around the table at Thanksgiving this year was a COVID friend. Every person sitting at the table was a friend that we made through the craziness of this past year. And so here's a question. Do the thousands of people who like this video, do the thousands of people who watch this video actually matter as the thousands of people? Or is it the connections that we are forming that actually has value? And the answer is, we've been lied to by suggesting that we value what we measure. Because then we make the mistake of measuring things that we want somebody to value. But the truth is, value actually is not how many. Value is how connected.
And how you feel.
How connected. Mm. Did you feel like you made a difference? Did you feel like you're part of a thing? Did you feel like you're not alone when you're sitting, whether you're sitting in Nantucket, or you're sitting in London, or you're sitting in Copenhagen, or you're sitting in Beijing, or you're sitting in Papua New Guinea, or you're sitting in Gold Coast, Australia, wherever you're sitting, can you feel like you're connected? Is there something about this butterfly? Is there something about this Facebook Live that makes you feel connected? And if that's the case, then shouldn't we be more concerned with the depth of connection, the essence of the interactions, than we are with the number of those interactions?
Yep.
And the answer is, unquestionably, thinking differently about commodity changes our value system, and we start valuing what matters, not what we measure.
Nice.
That's kind of important.
That's really important.
Going forward, let's ask the simple question. Will we be told what reality is? Or will we be let our senses and communities define what reality is? Will we allow ourselves the possibility of actually not listening to somebody else's definition of value? and rather let ourselves, let our experience, and let our interactions be what defines reality.
Yes. Perfect.
Commodity. The what is nature of reality opens up the first critical exploration of the what's next. Because we have been told what matters. We have been told what can be measured. We have been told what to accept as value or not value. We have been told what those things are. And far too often, we live and know a reality that doesn't match that. So in what comes next, the first thing that comes next is we will find ourselves most drawn to that which connects us and least drawn to the edges and boundaries that separate us. And with that, stay tuned for next week's episode on custom and culture, the way we perceive things. See you next week.
Thank you, everyone. Have a lovely, lovely week.